Today's class will be given by Her Grace Preeti Vilasini Mataji on the topic of Sri Bhagavat Mrita, Brihad Bhagavat Mrita. Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna Mataji, thank you so much. Thanks to everyone who joined. Please accept my dandavats at your lotus feet. Hare Krishna. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So we are continuing to read from Sri Brihad Bhagavatamrita. This is session number 8. In our previous session, we saw how Lord Shiva glorified the residents of Vaikuntha as being the greatest recipient of the Lord's mercy. And we saw how he gave various reasons why the residents of Vaikuntha are greater devotees than himself. And after he finished glorifying them, Mother Parvati, who was watching all this and listening to all what Shiva had to say, she became slightly disturbed because she felt Lord Shiva did not mention about the glories of Goddess Mahalakshmi. So Parvati Devi then glorified Goddess Shri and her unique position and the supreme devotion that she has to the Lord and how she as the mother is so merciful. So after Narada Muni heard all this, the glories of Vaikuntha, the glories of the devotees in Vaikuntha, the glories of his worshipable Lord Narayana and his most wonderful consort Lakshmi Devi, he became so excited and he began to sing the glories of Lakshmi Devi and Lord Narayan, and he looked upward like as if he was next ready to fly to Vaikuntha. So at that time, Lord Shiva held the hand of Narada Muni and stopped him. So we stopped at that point and we will continue from there. Om Agnyana Tinirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Meditam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Mukham Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langayate Girim Yat Kripatam Ham Vande Shri Gurum Dinatarinam Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Shri Mati Radhanatha Swaminitarame Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Shri Mati Bhakti Vedanta Swaminitarame Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharini Nirvitesha Shunyavadi Paschayatirishitarini Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabho Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaurabhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. So after Narada Muni heard the glories of the goddess of fortune and the residents of Vaikuntha, he became very, very, very ecstatic. He was so overwhelmed that at that minute he wanted to go there and go and see all of them. So, although at this point, the Supreme Lord Krishna was actually present in Dwaraka, we've seen this in our previous sessions as well, especially when Indra was talking, we saw how Indra was mentioning, just recently, actually, I offended the Lord in the Govardhan Leela. So we see that the entire setting of this Brihad Bhagavatamrita pastime was happening when Krishna was in Dwaraka. So at this point, the Supreme Lord was actually present in Dwaraka. And Narada Muni forgot about this, you know, because he was so overwhelmed with ecstasy when he heard about the glories of Vaikuntha. He was so overwhelmed. So immediately, all that he wanted to do is go and see the Lord in Vaikuntha and see Goddess Lakshmi. So he was very ecstatic. You know, he forgot this point that Lord Krishna was present in Dwaraka. But then Lord Shiva held his hand very, very lovingly and stopped him. So he stopped him to remind him that Krishna is performing his earthly pastimes. So if he goes to Dwaraka instead of going to Vaikuntha, actually he'll get a better opportunity to meet the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. So Lord Shiva stopped him and said, "Hey Narada Muni, have you forgotten? The Lord is in Dwaraka. You don't have to go all the way to Vaikuntha to see him." And Queen Rukmini, she in fact is the goddess of fortune. And Krishna is the original personality of Godhead. all the expansions of God of Rukmini actually accompany the Lord's expansions when they incarnate in their past tense. So just like how Krishna is just not a mere incarnation, but he is Swayam Bhagavan, similarly, Rukmini Devi is also the source of her further expansions, and she accompanies the Lord in her expansions as and when the Lord appears. So like this, Lord Shiva told Narada Muni, have you forgotten? You don't have to go to Vaikuntha because the Lord is present in Dwaraka. Now, of course, we have the supreme source who is Srimati Radharani, but Lord Shiva is not yet speaking about that because we are not there yet in the story. That will come much later. But now he says about Krishna and Rukmini, that they are in Dwaraka and you can go and see them there. Then Lord Shiva, after he said this, he thought for a moment and then he said, actually, my dear Brahman Narada, I have a big secret to tell you. You must hear this with great confidence. Come close to me. And then he began to whisper in the ear of Narada Muni. Actually, Lord Shiva didn't want Narada Muni to run to Vaikuntha at this point. Nor did Lord Shiva want Narada Muni to even go to Dwaraka. But in excitement, Lord Shiva said, yes, you can go to Dwaraka because, you know, Krishna is there, Rukmini is there. You can go and see them. But then he paused for a moment and he thought and he said, No. Actually, I don't want Narada Muni to either go to Vaikuntha nor go to Dwaraka. So he wanted to tell a secret in Narada Muni's ears. He wanted him to do something else at this particular point so that it will give him more realizations. So Lord Shiva, he wanted to whisper the secret in the ear of Narada Muni because he didn't want anyone else to hear the secret. So secretly, Lord Shiva told in the ears of Narada Muni, Narada, there is a greater recipient of Krishna's mercy than your father Brahma, than me, Shiva, than the goddess of fortune, Shri, or all the residents of Vaikuntha. And his name is Prahlada. And he is famous throughout this world as the most dear devotee of the Lord. So Krishna... he's there in Dwaraka, but then Narada Muni was told by Lord Shiva that before going anywhere else, actually, you must visit this particular devotee, Prahlada. His devotion to the Lord is very, very deep, and he is exceptionally dear to the Lord. In fact, he is dearer and he is greater than all the residents of Vaikuntha, like Garuda, the great general Vishvaksena, and even Lakshmi Devi. Actually, Prahlada is more dear than all of them. Then Lord Shiva reminded Narada Muni various verses from scriptures because Narada Muni is very learned. So Lord Shiva was telling him, don't you know? You have read all the scriptures by the mercy of your father. Don't you know all this? There are so many scriptural verses wherein Lord Krishna himself has declared this many, many times that his pure devotees are more dear to him than anybody else. So, especially we see this in Canto 9. There are three beautiful verses where the Lord declares this fact that his devotees are actually the most dear to him. So, this comes; these verses are spoken by the Lord in the context of the pastime when Ambarish Maharaj was offended by Durvasa. Very beautiful verses spoken by the Lord to Durvasa Muni about the glories of his devotees. So, we'll just read three verses where the Lord declares the special position of his devotees over everybody else, all his personal associates. Line 463. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said to the Brahmana, who is this Brahmana? This is Durvasa. And this is in the context of Durvasa offending Ambarish Maharaja, 9th canto. Okay? So we won't get into the story because all of you know the story of Ambarish. We'll just see these beautiful verses spoken by the mouth of the Supreme Lord himself. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said to the Brahmana Durvasa, I'm completely under the control of my devotees. Indeed, I'm not at all independent because my devotees are completely devoid of material desires. I sit only within the course of their hearts. What to speak of my devotee? Even those who are devotees of my devotees are very, very dear to me. Again, the very next verse the Lord says, O best of the Brahmanas, without saintly persons for whom I am the only destination, I don't desire to enjoy my transcendental bliss and my supreme opulences. A chaste woman bring their gentle husbands under control by service. The pure devotees who are equal to everyone and completely attached only to me in the core of their heart, they bring me under their full control. So like this, the Lord has declared, not only here, in so many places, He has declared this again and again. So here we see in these three verses that the Lord talks about the supreme position of a pure devotee and actually how he becomes completely in their control. He comes in their control. And of course, we have the most classic verse where the Lord clearly states that his devotee is dearer to him than any of his personal associates. This is a very famous verse. This comes in the 11th canto when Lord Krishna is talking to Uddhava. Na tatame priyatama atmayo nirna shankara na cha shashanko na shrir naivatma cha yatha bhavan. My dear Uddhava, neither Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, Lord Shankarsana, the goddess of fortune, nor indeed my own self are as dear to me as you are. So see, the Lord is talking about Brahma. He's talking about Shiva. He's talking about Shankarsan, Balram. He's talking about the goddess of fortune, Sridevi, his own consort. And he's saying, not just that, even my own self, he's talking about his own self. None of them are as dear to me as you are. And who is this you? You, in general, means the devotee, a pure devotee. And this, he was telling to Uddhava. This is a very great secret about the Lord. It appears that there are so many devotees, you know, so many personal associates getting association of the Lord. But the Lord clearly states, my pure devotee is the greatest. So here, the Lord openly declares that even his own personal form, his own self, all the opulences that he has, his personal expansion, nothing is dear to him as the pure devotees of the Lord. His opulences, his own sweetness, all this is unworthy of any attention as compared to the greatness of Vaishnavas. So, there are so many Vaishnavas. Moreover, among countless such pure devotees, Prahlad stands out as an example of perfection. And the good fortune of Prahlad is actually inconceivable. This is the statement of Lord Shiva. Why is that so? Because Prahlad doesn't have one trace of material motives. His surrender is complete, and the Lord himself has declared that during the pastime of Narsingh Dev in Canto 7, Chapter 10, Verse 21. The Lord says, Bhavanti purushaloke madbhakta swam anuvrata bhavan me kalu bhakta nam sarvesham pratirupadrak. Those who follow your example, Prahlad, will naturally become my pure devotees. You are the best example of my devotee. This is the words of the Lord. He's saying to Prahlad, you are the best example of my devotee and others should actually follow in your footsteps. So this is a verse by the Lord. He has given this verdict. Prahlad Maharaj is the best. Everyone follow in the footsteps of Prahlad Maharaj. And it's a very beautiful verse. And in that verse, Srila Prabhupada writes a purport. He says there are 12 Mahajans. Who are the 12 Mahajans? Swayambhur, Narada Shambhu, Kumara Kapilo Manuhu, Prahlado Janako Bhishmo, Balir, Vayasakir Vayam. The 12 authorized devotees of the Lord are Lord Brahma, Narada, Shiva, Kapila, Manu, and so on. And Prahlad is understood to be the best example as declared by Lord Narsingadev in Canto 7. So there may be 12 great authorities on devotional service, 12 great authorities on the details about the Lord, but who is the greatest? It is Prahlad. This is Narsingadev's verdict. So, what is this? Everyone is talking about Prahlad. Why is he so special? When the Lord tore apart Hiranyakashipu, actually everyone present there, Shiva, Brahma, many, many devotees, Garuda was there, Goddess of Fortune, Sridevi was there, all of them were there. But they all witnessed something special. They saw the special kindness the Lord showered towards Prahlad. Only Prahlad was able to pacify the Lord. No one else could even go near the Lord. Only Prahlad went. The minute Brahma told him, you go and pacify the Lord, immediately Prahlad was the one who stepped forward and he went and he pacified the Lord. Then Narsingadev, after being pacified, tried several times to offer him boons. Prahlad, he even refused to ask for liberation. The greatest boon one may want to ask. Prahlad even refused that. And all that he wanted was just pure devotion. So the Lord asked Prahlad repeatedly. And Prahlad did not choose liberation. All that he wanted repeatedly, again and again, is only for pure devotion. And Prahlad asked for pure devotion repeatedly in his future birth. He was ready to take birth again and again. How many other births there may be? Repeated births, but still, all that he wanted was pure devotion. Vishnu was trying to ask him repeatedly again and again, ask for something. But then what happened? He asked for pure devotion. So in Vishnu Purana, actually Parashara Muni, he records this request of Prahlad. This is a very nice verse from the Vishnu Purana, which Sanatana Goswami states to substantiate this point. So Prahlad says, O Master, in all the thousands of births through which I must wander in this world, please let me have unfailing devotion to you, the infallible Supreme Lord. Please give me this boon. So he's asking, all that I want is unfailing devotion. Of course, he asked his father to be liberated. But that was a mood of a Vaishnava and a mood of Paradukaduki. He wanted everyone to be liberated. He wanted his father also, the worst of the offender, to also be liberated. But the request that he had for himself was, please let me have unfailing devotion to you. How many other births I may have to take? How much ever I have to wander in this world? So Prahlad was ready to be born again and again, thousands of times, and he was not even interested in liberation. So that is Prahlad Maharaj. And who was Prahlad in Chaitanya Leela? Vasudeva Datta. What did Vasudeva Datta ask for? The same thing. He prayed for the same thing. Vasudeva Datta, he pleaded with the Lord, my heart breaks to see the suffering of all the people in this world. I beg you to please let all their sufferings and all their sinful reactions fall upon me and let them be awarded liberation and pure love. So this was the mood of Vasudeva Datta. And it may seem inconceivable how Vasudeva Datta is actually willing to suffer hellish condition for the rest of eternity just so that everyone else can be free from sins and enjoy Krishna. See, this consciousness is actually, it's nice, you know, it's nice to hear. Yes, he was so great, but it's very difficult to understand the actual consciousness of such a great devotee. How can he be like that? Is it for real? Is he really asking like this? Can anyone really think like this? So you see, for Vasudeva Datta, his happiness is Krishna's happiness. This is the mind of Vasudeva Datta. What was he happy about? He would be happy if Krishna is happy. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he came to this world to deliver the world. And what makes him happy? If everyone goes back to Godhead, Mahaprabhu will be happy. If Mahaprabhu is happy, Vasudeva Datta is happy. So Vasudeva Datta is saying that in his hellish sufferings also, he will enjoy better than anyone else. Why? Because he's not enjoying for himself. Rather, he was thinking of the enjoyment of Krishna. His enjoyment was in giving Krishna pleasure. So by doing this, he was giving Krishna pleasure. So he was not thinking like, I'll enjoy higher happiness because I am giving Krishna pleasure. No, this is not the thinking of Vasudeva Datta. He was not thinking that if Krishna's happy, I will get pleasure. No, he was not even thinking like that. All that he was thinking is, I want to give Krishna pleasure. That's all. It doesn't matter. I'll go to hellish planet, I'll be happy. That's fine. It's okay. Why? Because Krishna is getting happiness like that. So, that was the consciousness of Vasudeva Datta, and that is the consciousness of Prahlad, who actually came as Vasudeva Datta. And he said, all that I need is pure devotion. Doesn't matter where I go, because I know if I do this, the Lord is going to be happy. Like that. So Lord Shiva, he further cited the example of Bali Maharaj. After describing the unique devotion of Prahlad Maharaj, who is very, very special, and he has a very special position over anyone else, and the Lord has declared it. After he said all this, Lord Shiva further, he gave the example of Bali Maharaj and Banasura in comparison with Prahlad. Now, this is something that is very interesting to understand. So we all know, you know, just now we just saw the verse of the 12 Mahajans, and we saw Bali Maharaj was also one of them, right? So, Lord Shiva goes on further to explain about the other demons, whom we also celebrate. It's not only Prahlad that we celebrate as being a great devotee, we also celebrate Bali Maharaj. We saw how he actually gave everything to the Lord, right? So, now Lord Shiva wanted to clarify a few points before Narada gets confused. Narada may think, yeah, Prahlad has received great mercy, but hasn't Bali Maharaj or Bhanasura also received similar mercy? This doubt may come in Narada Muni's mind. So Lord Shiva wanted to clarify that. Now, Hiranyakashipu's son was Prahlad. Prahlad's son was Virochan. Virochan's son was Bali Maharaj, and Bali Maharaj's son was Bhanasura. So this is a relationship. They are all different generations. First Hiranyakashipu, then Prahlad, then Virochan, then Bali Maharaj and Bhanasura. So all of them were from the same family of demons, right? But there was some sense of difference in their characters. Very, you know, subtle differences that you can see in the character of all of them. So Lord Shiva told Narada Muni, just think about the great Bali Maharaj. He celebrated for his perfection of the principle of Atmanivedanam. So we know Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, like that. Each one has perfected one thing. We know that Shravanam was perfected by Parikshit, Kirtanam was perfected by Shukadeva, like that. So many examples we hear Bali Maharaj had perfected this principle of Atmanivedanam. It's not easy. Atmanivedanam is not easy. It's not like, you know, something very, you can't take it cheaply. It's very difficult. He exemplified this. He gave everything, his property, his personal body, everything, each and everything that he had, he dedicated it to the Lord. So in exchange, Vamanadev, Lord Vamana became his doorkeeper. Being pleased with the surrender of Bali, Vamanadev said, "My dear Bali Maharaj, you are such a great devotee. So in return for your service, I will always remain your doorkeeper." So because the Lord accepted to become the doorkeeper of Bali Maharaj, one may suggest that Bali Maharaj is actually more fortunate than Prahlad, because the Lord didn't give him this boon. The Lord didn't say, "I will become your personal doorkeeper." No, the Lord gave his boon to Bali Maharaj. So it may appear that, oh, Bali may be greater than Prahlad. But then Lord Shiva explains that it is not really true, because Bali Maharaj made many mistakes. Bali Maharaj invaded heaven. He usurped the throne of Indra. Because of doing that, he disturbed the natural order set by Brahma, that the demigods should rule the heavenly planets and the demons should rule the subterranean planets. So Bali Maharaj also, not only did he disturb the natural order that was set by Brahma, he also gave a very big promise. He gave a very big promise to do and give whatever the Lord wanted. And the Lord came as Vamanadev. He wanted 3 pages of land. And Bali Maharaj, very, very nicely, he promised. He said, "I will give you whatever you want. What is this? You're just asking for 3 pages of land. You're not very intelligent. Ask for something big with this tiny feet of yours. You're just asking for 3 pages of land. I am the king. I can give you anything." He was very confident that he could satisfy this little Brahmin boy, Vamanadev. But then what happened after that? With one step, the Lord covered the upper planetary systems. The second step, the Lord, he covered the lower planetary system. And the third step, the Lord asked Bali Maharaj, "Where should I keep this third step?" Bali Maharaj's promise was impossible to fulfill. His promise actually proved false. The Lord said, actually, in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 8, 21, 32, he says, "Because you have been unable to give charity according to your promise, the rule is that you should go down to live in the hellish planets. Therefore, in accordance with the order of Shukracharya, your spiritual master, now you go down and live there." This was the words of the Lord. He said, "You didn't fulfill your promise, go down to hellish planets." Actually, Shukracharya predicted this. He told his dear disciple, Bali Maharaj, don't do this. Don't do this. You won't be able to fulfill your promise. The Lord is very smart. He knows how to take everything from you. Don't do this. But then he said, if you do this, you will be sent to hellish planets because you will simply not be able to fulfill your promise. When you don't fulfill the promise of a Brahmana, you go to hell. So this was the words of Shukracharya. So the Lord is saying, in accordance to the order of Shukracharya, your spiritual master, now you will go down and live there. So far from being elevated to the heavenly planets or fulfilling one's desire, one who does not properly give a beggar what he has promised falls down to the hellish condition of life. Being falsely proud of your position, you promised to give me land, but you could not fulfill your promise. Therefore, because your promise was false, you must live for a few years in hellish life. This is from Srimad Bhagavatam. The Lord said this. And Bali Maharaj said, oh my Lord, please don't think that I wanted to cheat you. That was not my intention. I must somehow or the other fulfill my promise. I still have my body. So you place your third place of land in my body. You just place your foot on my body. Then I place my body for your satisfaction. Please put your third step on my head. Bali Maharaj said, since the Lord had covered the entire universe with two steps, one may ask, how is it that Bali Maharaj's head could be sufficient for the third step? How is it? Because he is also included in the universe, right? So Bali Maharaj, however, thought, this was the thinking of Bali Maharaj. Bali Maharaj thought, though, you know, this is what his, he was a great devotee, this is the thought, that the possessor of the wealth must be greater than the possession. And this is true. The possessor of the wealth is actually greater than the possession. It is true. It to some extent, yes, that is correct. So this is the thought of Bali Maharaj. Therefore, although the Lord had taken all his possessions, the head of Bali Maharaj, the possessor of all the wealth, could provide adequate space for the Lord's third step. This is a logical thing that Bali Maharaj tells. I mean, or rather it is said in the purport and it is explained how Bali Maharaj actually substantiates the point that his head is actually the third spot where the Lord can keep his foot. Okay, but then see what happens. Vindhyavali. Who was Vindhyavali? Vindhyavali was the wife of Bali Maharaj. So the wife of Bali Maharaj, we know, the wife is always there when a king makes the charity or any grihastha. So nothing is complete without the sanction of the wife, right? So she plays a very important role, and Srimad Bhagavatam, we can read about her, how chaste she was. She was a very, very dear wife of Bali Maharaj. But actually, she was not only just dear to her husband, and she was very chaste, but also she was very intelligent. And what kind of intelligence? Very good intelligence. And she calls her husband as less intelligent. Because we see there's a very beautiful verse, and again in Srimad Bhagavatam, Srimati Vindhyavali said, see how nicely Shukadeva Goswami is talking about her. Srimati Vindhyavali said, oh my Lord, you have created this entire universe for the enjoyment of your personal pastimes. But foolish, unintelligent men have claimed proprietorship for material enjoyment. Certainly they are shameless agnostics. Falsely claiming proprietorship, they think they can give charity and enjoy. In such a condition, what good can they do for you who are the independent creator, maintainer, and annihilator of this universe? Such wise words by Vindhyavali Devi, who is the wife of Bali Maharaj. 8:22:20. You can read this purport. It's such a beautiful purport by Srila Prabhupada. And it just gives you so much insights about the great character of Vindhyavali Devi. So Vindhyavali was actually a very loving wife. She was not only concerned about whatever was good for her husband, and you know, she was actually very, very chaste. She was very chaste. She was concerned always about the best of that her husband should have. It was not just about the material possessions. Rather, she was thinking how he can spiritually advance. That is the duty of a wife, right? The duty of a wife is not only to help her husband to advance materially, but the most important thing is to help her advance spiritually, help her husband advance spiritually. And the same thing applies to the husband. That is the idea of getting married, actually. One of the most important promises that we take during the time of marriage is to help each other understand the supreme truth. That is the most important vow that we take during marriage. Yes, we stay together as a family, we do this, we do that, all that is there. But when we go around the fire and we take a promise, the biggest promise that we make is we help each other advance in Krishna consciousness, understand who is God and work towards it. That is the promise that we give our husband. That is the promise that the husband gives the wife, right? So Vindhyavali, she was very aware of this promise. She was thinking, right now, I have nothing. My husband is imprisoned. He's arrested. But he is getting the special mercy of Krishna. He is going back to Godhead eventually. This is the success of our marriage. This is what she was thinking. And she was thinking, this is indeed the greatest opulence. And the opulence of Krishna's mercy was being received by Bali Maharaj. So he is the supreme treasure of all wealth, right? I mean, Krishna is everything. She was very happy for her husband. She was so chaste. She was so happy. But there is something very important she said in this verse. She knew that he was not very intelligent. So Prabhupada in the purport, he explains that Bali Maharaj's wife was actually very intelligent. She supported her husband, but she accused him of having no intelligence. Because, why? Because he had claimed the proprietorship of the property of the Lord. Everything is the property of the Lord. Right? Be it the, you know, all these, what are those 14 universes? Everything is a property of the Lord. Did Bali Maharaj really own the 14 worlds? No, Vindhyavali pointed that out. She said, no, everything is the property of the Lord. So such a claim is a sign of demoniac life. She calls them shameless agnostics, claiming false proprietorship. These are the words of Vindhyavali. So she says, such a claim is a sign of demoniac life. She was calling her husband a demon. Very obvious, but still, she was calling her husband a demon. Although the demigods were officials appointed by the Lord for management, they are attached to material enjoyment, yes, but they never claimed to be the proprietor of the universe. But Bali Maharaj, being in the family of demons, which was natural, you know, in one sense, because they are in the family of demons, he claimed proprietorship. So Bali Maharaj's wife accused Bali Maharaj by saying that although the Supreme Personality of Godhead arrested him, showing him extraordinary mercy, and although Bali Maharaj was offering his body to the Supreme Lord for the third step, still, it is in the darkness of ignorance. She was accusing him of being in the darkness of ignorance, although he just surrendered everything. Just imagine, you're surrendering everything. You're surrendering your body. That is a great thing. It is nothing to be looked down upon, right? It's such a big deal. Just imagine from the point of view of Bali Maharaj. It's a great thing. But then his wife is accusing him of being in the darkness of ignorance after he surrendered everything. This was because she was so wise and intelligent that she understood that her husband actually had nothing to surrender, for everything was already Krishna's property. In fact, that you think that you're giving something to Krishna itself is an illusion. Radhanath Maharaj explains in this context of this particular verse. He talks about this in detail. He says the very idea that you get, you know, in your mind that you are giving something to Krishna, that itself is an illusion. Actually, the body also did not belong to Bali Maharaj. Even the body that he's saying, put your feet on my head, even that body doesn't belong to him. Why did he have these ideas? Because of his long-standing demoniac mentality, he could not understand this. He thought that since he had been defamed for his inability to fulfill his promise of charity, and since the body belonged to him, he would become free. He could free himself from this defamation. He could free himself from having this debt of not offering something to a Brahmana by offering his body. Actually, however, the body itself does not belong to anyone but the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Who has given this body? How is that? It's stated in the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, Ishvara sarvabhutanam siddheshe arjuna tishtati brahmayan sarvabhutanam yantra rudani maya. The Lord is situated in everyone's heart. According to the material desires of the living entity, the Lord offers a particular type of machine, the body, through the agency of material energy. The body actually doesn't belong to the living entity. It belongs to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Under these circumstances, how could Bali Maharaj claim that the body belonged to him? Thus, Vindhyavalli, Bali Maharaj's very intelligent wife, prayed that her husband to be released by the Lord's causeless mercy. Like this, finally, you know, her prayers were very intelligent actually. She understood, yes, Atmanivedanam was not easy. We must bear in mind that of course Bali Maharaj was a very great devotee. He is a Mahajan. And we are trying to understand here, what is that Sanatana Goswami is trying to reveal here? It's not that we are trying to put down Bali Maharaj. No, he's a great devotee from his, you know, he's great. I mean, we cannot even, who are we, right? He's so wonderful. But the point that Sanatana Goswami is trying to make here is that Prahlad is actually a greater devotee among all the demons there. Bali Maharaj perfected Atmanivedanam. That is not easy. It's a very great form of devotion. This Bali Maharaj, without any duplicity, without the slightest hesitation, he offered everything in the three worlds and even himself to the Lord. How many people can do that? He's amazing. He's wonderful. Bali Maharaj became the most famous among all the demons and the non-believers. So in spite of being bereft of all the material opulences that he had, he was very fixed in his devotional service. That is very difficult. You know, everything is going away from you. Will you be fixed in devotional service? Bali Maharaj proved that he can be fixed in devotional service. That is the greatness of Bali Maharaj. But now, Lord Shiva proposes this fact. It seems, actually, Bali Maharaj did not give away anything very important. What did he give? He just gave the insignificant material world and his insignificant body. What did he give? That's all. Vamanadev becoming the doorkeeper of Bali Maharaj could not have been the result of this meager charity. Lord Shiva is saying it's meager charity. Okay, for the little we have and we give charity, we think we have given something big. Look at Bali Maharaj. He has given the universe. He has, you know, he's the emperor of the entire universe. He's given everything. He's given his own body. Right? It's a big charity. But Lord Shiva here is saying it's meager charity. The Lord must have reciprocated with Bali Maharaj in this way, not for the so-called spontaneous charity that he gave. Because this, what charity? Everything belongs to the God, Lord Shiva is saying. So the Lord has not reciprocated with him for the so-called spontaneous charity that he gave. But because Prahlad is a pure devotee of the Lord, you know, that is the reason why the Lord accepted to become the doorkeeper of Prahlad's grandson. Bali didn't deserve this because he was a violator of the universal order, he was a transgressor of his guru's order, and he was a breaker of promises. He promised the Lord and he broke his promise. So Bali's insignificant charity couldn't have purchased the Supreme Lord. The only explanation that can be offered, Lord Shiva is saying, for Bali's good fortune is the exchange of prema bhakti between Bali Maharaj and his worshipable Lord. So, because of Bali's relationship with Prahlad, the Lord decided to become his doorkeeper on the Sutala planet. In fact, Prahlad is very, very special. That's why Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita 10:30, he says, Prahladas chasmi daityanam. Among the daityas, I am Prahlad. Very famous verse when the Lord talks about his opulences. At that time, when he chooses to pick someone among the daityas, he actually picks Prahlad. He doesn't pick anybody else. He picks Prahlad. So Lord Shiva next explains, similarly, just like how we saw that Bali Maharaj's mercy that he had received was only because of Prahlad, similarly, the mercy shown on Bhanasura, who is Bali Maharaj's son, is not because of the Lord's compassion on Lord Shiva. See, in our previous session, previous to this session, maybe session 6 or 7, we saw this point, that the Lord showed mercy to Bhanasura because he was a great devotee of Lord Shiva. We saw this explanation. But here, Lord Shiva is actually rejecting that idea. He says that Bhanasura became an object of the Lord's mercy not because he was dear to Lord Shiva, rather, it is because of his relationship with Prahlad Maharaj. We saw the family tree, right? So he said, because of Prahlad, The Lord decided to be merciful to Banasura and give him that four-armed form and make him an eternal associate of Lord Shiva. Because of Prahlad Maharaj's special position, the Lord became merciful to Bali. He became merciful to Banasura. Okay, so Lord Shiva explains that Banasura was favored by the Lord not because of me. Actually, this Bana even went to the extent of offending Lord Shiva, inviting him for a fight. So, the Lord awarded him a four-armed form and made him an eternal associate of Lord Shiva only in return to the pure devotion of Prahlad, because Banasura was the great-grandson of Prahlad Maharaj. So the Lord elevated all these asuras only to please Prahlad. Like this, Lord Shiva, he explained to Narada Muni, the greatest recipient, even among the demons, if you think, oh, maybe Banasura is great, oh, maybe Bali Maharaj is great. No, it is Prahlad Maharaj. So then after speaking so much in favor of Prahlad, Lord Shiva stopped. Although Narada Muni wanted to hear more and more glories of Prahlad, he was getting more and more excited. The more he heard about Prahlad Maharaj, he was getting more and more excited. But then Lord Shiva was very conscious of the fact that Parvati Devi is there close by. He's trying to whisper all this into the ear of Narada Muni. And he didn't want Narada Muni to get into some kind of excitement because Parvati Devi was standing there and she is the great friend of the goddess of fortune, Lakshmi Devi. So he didn't want to continue speaking like this and let Narada go into an ecstasy again. And Parvati wouldn't like to hear, you know, Prahlad being praised as a greater devotee than the dear consorts of the Lord. You know, how will Parvati tolerate that? You're telling that some devotee is greater than the goddess of fortune? She's not going to be happy. So if Parvati reacts negatively, then it would become a problem. So Lord Shiva was scared about this. He didn't want any disrespect to Narada. So he just told some limited details and he stopped. So after he stopped, what was the next plan? The next plan was to go and see Prahlad Maharaj. So before that, I just want to summarize, because there is so much story, inside story, inside story. I just wanted to summarize the highlighted points put forth by Lord Shiva. These are the points put forth by Lord Shiva in favor of Prahlad as being the greatest devotee. Because when Narsingadev tore apart Hiranyakashipu, even Lakshmi couldn't approach him, but Prahlad was able to. And all that Prahlad asked from the Lord was pure devotional service. Bali Maharaj disobeyed his guru's order. He didn't fulfill his promise. And he was a transgressor of universal order. And still the Lord became his doorkeeper. Why? That is because of his special relationship with Prahlad Maharaj. Same thing with Banasura. Banasura was granted protection by him. Why? Because of his affection for Prahlad. And then even though the Lord is very attached to Lakshmi and all the other associates like Garuda, Vishwakseen, all of them, he still has a special place for the heart of his new devotees like Prahlad, who have undergone great difficulties for him. So Lord Shiva told Narada Muni to go and see Prahlad. Narada Muni told, Lord Shiva told Narada Muni to go to Sutala planetary system to see Prahlad there, because he was residing in Sutala with his grandson now. We know that Bali Maharaj was sent to the planet of Sutala, right? When he was pushed down, he was sent to the planet of Sutala. But then, after, you know, if you read in the 8th canto, you will see that the Supreme Lord requested Prahlad to go and stay there for a while. This is the verse that says that, the Supreme Personality of Godhead said, "My dear son Prahlada, all good fortune unto you. For the time being, please go to the place known as Sutala and there enjoy happiness with your grandson and all your other relatives and friends." 823.9. So Lord Shiva told Narada Muni to go to Sutala and find Prahlad there. So Lord Shiva told Narada Muni, you go there, go and offer blessings to Prahlad. You go and embrace him and tell Prahlad that I also embrace him again and again. But make sure that in your ecstasy, you don't go and offer obeisances. Because if you go and show all this respect and you offer obeisances and offer prayers to him as a great devotee, he's going to get very disturbed. He'll become very unhappy. He won't even talk to you. So be very careful when you deal with a devotee. don't go and pay your obeisances. Rather, you offer blessings as a sage. You go there, you offer blessings, say all good fortune unto you, go and embrace him. If you feel like falling at his feet, don't do that, go and embrace him. So when he heard these instructions, Narada Muni was very happy and he traveled to Sutala Loka by the path of his heart. Very nice. What is the meaning of by the path of his heart? It means at the speed of mind. He thought I should be in Sutala the next minute. Narada Muni was in Sutala Loka. And he saw there, Prahlad was sitting there and meditating. So we'll stop there. We'll see what happened when he saw Prahlad, how Prahlad received him, what was the conversation that Prahlad had with Narada Muni. So any questions, comments, corrections, realizations, please go ahead. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prithvi Vilasini Mataji. Very, very nice. Have you Katha. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Kaumudi Mataji. Such a blessing to have you. Thank you.
But I am an offender. I didn't. You say, you know, I didn't even think about it. And just this morning, I thought, wow, today is Thursday, and I was supposed to do welcoming on Tuesday. Oh, Krishna.
Oh, Mataji, it's such a small thing. I mean, don't worry. Absolutely no worries. Please. Thank you, Mataji. Thank you for coming. Just your association is so illuminating for all of us. Thank you for coming.
Hi, Krishna Preeti Vilasini Mataji. Agwa Shiva Prabhupada. Wonderful class, of course, as always. I was on a little late, so I missed a little bit of the beginning, but couple of thoughts that came to my mind was,
yes.
One thing I was just thinking about, can you hear me, Mataji? I'm outside.
Yeah.
I was just thinking about, the wives of all these people, Bali Maharaj's wife. I'm sorry, tell me her name, Vindhyalaya?
Vindhyavali.
Thinking about Bali's wife, Tara, and Ravana's wife, Mandodari, all these women, you know, we realize that they are so chaste, and they say that a lot of the power of their husbands or the protection of their husbands, longevity of their husbands is because of this purity of their wives. Mm. And then they, and they give them such sound advice, right? Tara tells her husband, give back your brother's wife. Don't go there. There's something going on. This Rama is not an ordinary person. Mandodari tells her husband the same thing. And, again, Vindhyavali is telling her husband also. And, they don't, it seems, this is my mental speculation, they don't value or don't appreciate, don't understand the power and the potency of their wives. So, it's just a thought. It's just a lesson for many of us to, take heed of advice is one thing I was thinking of. And the other point I was thinking was, Prahlad Maharaj says that so many generations will be saved. Or I'm not sure exactly what the correct translation, correct message was. And so here we see all those descendants of Prahlad Maharaj actually becoming liberated one way or another. So that's interesting right there. Because I always wondered, where's evidence of that? How do we know that? But here we see that right here in these stories that you've told. So those are two things, which is really wonderful. And please do send this as quick as possible so I can listen to the beginning part. Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Paneshwari Lakshmi Mataji. Thank you so much. And as usual, when you give your realization, that's the best part of the class at the end. So I wait for these little realizations that all of you share. Thank you.
I'm just thinking, the Bhagavatam has so many wonderful lessons for couples, you know, in their stories. I think, I mean, I'm just thinking in my head, what a wonderful, you know, just making a list of all the lessons from the Bhagavatam for married couples that we could get from this, you know, these stories. I just, idea pops in my head, so maybe we'll do this.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Nice, Mataji. Very nice. Very nice initiative. Thank you. It would be nice to share it with everyone.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Very, very beautiful class. Thank you so much, Mataji.
Thank you so much, Vinaya, Mataji, for joining. Thank you for coming, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Dhanmas Pranam. Chita Priti Devi Das here. Mataji, now, I was just thinking, like, Bali Maharaj, and the all generations following Prahlad Maharaj. So was it just the Lord's arrangement that this was the way that they were going to get liberated, because Prahlad Maharaj had a boon from, or Prahlad Maharaj had asked it to the Lord? Is it in that way?
So the question you're asking is, did the specific past tense happen just for the sake of Prahlad Maharaj? Is that what you're asking? Or what is the exact question?
Yeah, like, because Prahlad Maharaj had a boon that all his future generations will be liberated. So that is the reason all these, because if we say Bali Maharaj, these all, they were already having so much of knowledge, right? Like, they were having so much of devotion. Then too, they did some wrong things. So was it just an arrangement of the Lord, or it had to happen in this way?
Oh, them making mistakes, was it the arrangement of the Lord, is what you're asking?
Yeah.
Well, it can be seen from different points of view. Of course, Sanatan Goswami is telling us here that because of the special relationship with Prahlad, because, you know, when a devotee is very dear to the Lord, all his associates, all the devotees' relatives, all the devotees' close friends, relatives, everyone become automatically dear to the Lord. So, in the case of Prahlad and all his relatives, it so happens that, you know, this is the point Sanatan Goswami is talking here. He's saying, yes, because Prahlad was so dear to him, all his family members became dear to the Lord, right? But again, that is true. That is the thing. That is the thing that we understand. Similarly, even in our Krishna consciousness movement, whenever a pure devotee, like disciples of Prabhupada, you will see their entire family is actually getting benefited by Krishna consciousness. You will see all of them are being delivered by the Lord. The Lord doesn't leave even their parents, you know. He makes sure that even they are delivered. You can hear many stories about this. So yes, that is the chief point that is being told here. But again, we don't in any way say that Bali was any less devotee as well, because the principle of Atmanivedanam that he exemplified is simply not easy. It doesn't come like that, right? So they did have their qualifications, but the Lord ultimately, you know, that mercy is flowing. I mean, there's an extra mercy flowing because of their relationship with Prahlad Maharaj. And that's why the Lord personally said, I will come and be your doorkeeper. The Lord needn't have done that, right? If you look at the past, and it's not necessary for the Lord to say, I will come and be your doorkeeper. Where is the need? Bali didn't ask the Lord to come and be his doorkeeper. No. He did that purely for the sake of Prahlad. So the entire pastime as such never happened in the way that it's only to, you know, fulfill a promise. No, it's not like that. But we can see the highlight of the pastime of the Lord agreeing to become subservient to Bali Maharaj and becoming his doorkeeper is because of the special favor that he's trying to show to Prahlad and the associates of Prahlad, because that will make Prahlad happy. It's like that. But the entire pastime or the individual characteristics of Bali Maharaj is his own. That is the nature of Bali Maharaj. He was very nice. He was very giving. And he understood, if the Supreme Lord comes, you should give everything, you know. That principle was there in his heart. So that is all naturally there in Bali Maharaj. So it is not like everything, see, when we talk about, you know, sometimes the Lord chooses some special devotees to show as example, to represent something wrong. Like, for example, Bhishma Dev was put in a particular situation from whom he made a mistake, and probably everyone learned from him. Like that, you know, he chooses. Sometimes Indra, he's portrayed, poor Indra. I mean, like, so many stories, all bad, bad things we hear about him. But sometimes the Lord chooses some of his pure devotees, some of his close devotees in some cases, to teach the world something. So like that, yes, that also happens. But we don't say everything is only a drama and it was orchestrated only by the Lord just for teaching. We also have their individual nature. The individual pastimes happen. All this is there. Of course, the underlying principle is that the Lord, ultimately, he wanted to favor all the descendants for the sake of Prahlad. Because of his love, for the exchange of love that Prahlad showed to the Lord, which no one else actually did to that extent. Somewhat, did it answer, Mataji, or did you get what I was trying
yes.
to say?
Yes, Mataji, yes. Yes. Thank you, Mataji.
Okay. Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna. And if anyone wants to add to this, they can add.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you so much for the wonderful class, Mataji. Mataji, I have one question. Like, you are saying the dependent get liberated, like 21 generation. I have a confusion. Like, they will directly get liberated, or like they will get some like. In devotional service, they will get like some benefits, like they will get association, so they can get, like, they don't have to do any devotional service, or they will directly get liberated. How?
So that's a good question. We see most of these cases these devotees, it's not like immediately they died and they got liberation. No, the Lord says that he will take care of them. He'll ultimately liberate all of them. So in the case of Prahlad, and in the case of Bali, and in the case of Banasura, you see that they were actually, at least Bali Maharaj and Prahlad, we see they were living in the Sutala planet. So it's not that immediately, you know, the minute the Lord kept the third step, this Bali Maharaj was liberated and he went to Vaikuntha. No, he's going to be the next Indra as well, you know. The Bali Maharaj is the next Indra, right? Because he had this desire that he wanted to assert Indra's position. The Lord is fulfilling that also. So the Lord is making him next the Indra. But then his devotion, he will not, the Lord will make sure that he maintains his devotional service. And ultimately, they reach the Lord. So that is the idea. They are protected by the Lord. They are given personal protection by the Lord they are getting. And they will maintain their devotional service so that they don't forget the Lord. Is that okay, Mataji?
Yes, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Navani Mataji. Yeah, you look at the case of Bali Maharaj. I mean, it's not a short story. It goes on and on. He was going to be liberated, but look at his term of, rulership. Now he's on the Sutala. Next, after this period of this Indra, Purandara, right? He's the Indra now. After his period, next is going to be Bali's period of being Indra, next Manvantara. So, such a long period. But then the Lord is saying that, I will not forget you. I will make sure that you come to me. So he's giving that promise. Thank you, Mataji. Again, I mean, the other thing that I wanted to mention is that it doesn't mean that it will not be instant as well. There are so many cases where the Lord liberates the devotee because of his connection with some other pure devotee, and they go to Godhead immediately also. That, I mean, there is no hard and fast rule that, oh, you have to still stay here and, you know, you... No, it depends on the person. It depends on the situation. It depends on so many specific details. In the case of Bali Maharaj, it was not immediate. That's all. But there can be immediate cases as well. Like we hear so many stories, and even within our own ISKCON movement, that there have been cases of immediate liberation as well because of their connection to a pure devotee. So that is also possible. Anything is possible by the Lord.
Hare Krishna, Sridhi Virasini Mataji. Also, the case of Putana.
Yes.
Was she not the... Sometimes I hear daughter, sometimes I hear sister of Bali Maharaj.
Putana was Ratnamala. Ratnamala was a sister, sometimes they say daughter, sister or daughter, usually they say sister, I think, sometimes in some places it said daughter as well. She had this tendency, she was also favored, that's a good point that you're making. She was also favored, being in the king, from the Demonia clan, she was very highly favored, and she became the Dhatri, the nurse in the spiritual world, Good point, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Dandavad.
I think you just said that Putana, being that she was from the demoniac clan, she was also favored. But...
So there are many layers, Mataji. Like, of course, she had a plan to kill the Lord. She was thinking when Vamadev came, this Ratnamala, she was thinking, how beautiful this boy is. I wish he could suck on my breast. I wish I could be his mother. She was thinking like that. And when he became so big and he took 3 steps of land, she was thinking, how horrible. I wish I could kill him. So there are different layers, And eventually also she was connected to this particular family of Prahlad, and the Lord had many layers in favoring her, and ultimately she was favored. Of course, she earned her own credibility in the sense of having a desire to give milk to the Lord. So, it's all there, Mataji.
Yeah. So, I just found it strange when you said that she was from the demoniac clan, because it made it sound as though it was because she had that connection to a demoniac clan, where normally I would think
in the sense, my wording was not good. It's not that she had a connection with a demoniac clan, rather she had a connection with the devotees like Prahlad and others, that's what I mean, or Bali Maharaj.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you. Yes, now it makes sense.
Sorry for that.
No problem. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gaurangi Mata.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
You know, and another thing I was thinking, Preeti Virasini, is that it seems that all of these demons, whatever this clan, had to have some purification they had to go through. So it was almost like they had, it was not pure devotion for any of them.
Right.
If you think about it, it was some kind of adulterated version.
Yeah.
So there was that. And so in the case of Putana, as we discussed before, it was because of that, the ultimate mercy of the Lord. And when you were saying it's up to His, it's Krishna's mercy, I think that's the key word here. So, like the law of karma, it's just like you said, it has so many layers. We don't know how people are... how the law of karma actually works. There's just so many layers. And also how this whole process of devotion also works, as far as when does the Krishna's mercy come in, when does our free will come in, when does something that our forefathers have done come in. It's also very, 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 very layered and very, very deep. And it's sometimes hard for us to understand. I think it's
very
just
true.
Certain lessons we need to take. And anyway, that's what I was thinking, that it was just purification. She had this pure thought, this little pure thought, and we know that the love of a mother to a child is the most pure of everything in this world as far as love goes.
Wow.
So that in itself was, it wasn't just, so I think it's that degree or whatever, that little bit of a minute difference that gave her a little bit more of a push, that she obviously got, immediate liberation. Versus her brothers who didn't get that, So.
Very nice. I'm reminded of your class that you gave recently about Putana. Very nice, Mataji. Thank you, Mataji.
Okay. So if no one else has any questions or comments, we can end the call here. Thank you all so much for the very nice participation. It was very nice discussing with all of you. We'll end the call. Luncheon is for the
हरे कृष्ण
थैंक यू।